This is the Katherine Ferguson Academy. It is a public school in Detroit, Michigan. You may notice a couple of things right away about the students at Katherine Ferguson Academy in this footage and the rest of it that we've got. They're all girls, for one thing. And if you look closely, you may notice that some of them appear to be pregnant. Also, they're farming. Yes, they are. They are picking apples and growing lettuce and raising animals in Detroit. In Detroit, in inner city Detroit. This is not some extracurricular activity thing. This is part of what they do at Katherine Ferguson High School. The school is named after Katherine Ferguson, who was born a slave. Her mother was sold and taken away from her when Katherine Ferguson was 8 years old. When she was 16 years old, somebody bought her out of slavery for $200. She then spent the rest of her life mothering lost kids and providing religious instruction. She reportedly founded the first Sunday school ever in New York City, though she herself remained illiterate all of her life. The school named in her honor in Detroit welcomes specifically pregnant girls, or girls who have kids. It exists for them. It is one of the only places like it in the country. Your life isn't over because you got pregnant. There is still school for you, public school. There is a daycare on site to take care of your kids while you go to class. There is an expectation that you will get accepted to college if you stick it out and graduate from here. There's parenting classes and support alongside the rest of your coursework, but your coursework is for real. Katherine Ferguson Academy was named a breakthrough high school by the National Association of Secondary School Principals.
I want everybody to have the same opportunity that I had. I got out of here. I want you to graduate the same way I did. I got two kids. You can make it with one, two, or how many of you got? They're going to make it happen. Ms. Andrews, make it happen.
She says Mrs. Andrews will make it happen. Mrs. Andrews is the school principal, Ms. Asenath Andrews. Looking around at the resources available to her school and her students, this principal decided to take advantage of one thing that Detroit came to have, even as the inner city of Detroit hollowed out over these last decades. Detroit, frankly, has some space. Detroit has some room to work.
We have a garden now. We have a big garden, and they call it the farm because we have these animals and stuff. I need to figure out how kids can make about $20,000 a year minimum farming.
Taking what resources they've got and doing with them what they can. One of the requirements for graduation at Katherine Ferguson is you must get accepted to a college. Principal Andrews and her staff will hunt down a college for you to go to and money for you to go there if you graduate. I do not want to pretend that this is in any way an easy thing, but if you come to that school as a junior or a senior, and again, you come here because you have become a very young mother or you're about to, from this school, Principal Andrews says you have a 90% chance of graduating. We spent time on this show this week telling you about another hard luck place in the great state of Michigan, Benton Harbor, where this month, to the outrage of many of the people in Benton Harbor, a state-appointed emergency financial overseer just took over the city. The mayor and the entire city commission were stripped of their powers. There's one man sent from the state in unilateral control of that city now. The city's elected officials are not running that city, not anymore. Emergency managers are not a new idea in Michigan. They've been around for a long time. The Detroit Public Schools have been run by an emergency manager since the last governor was in charge, a Democrat, Jennifer Granholm. But last month, the new Republican governor, Rick Snyder, signed a new emergency manager law, which you could call emergency manager on steroids. Or if you really don't like it, you could call it financial martial law. This new bill contains more than a dozen new triggers for getting put under emergency rule. And it gives an emergency overseer in a town or in a school district, it gives that overseer astounding amounts of new power. The Detroit schools manager told the Detroit News he had been frustrated under the old manager law. Detroit was still allowed to have an elected school board, and those locally elected officials did not always want what he wanted, which he found frustrating. The new law passed by Republican Governor Rick Snyder, though, would do away with that complication. And that new power has the Detroit School's emergency overseer guy licking his chops. And I'm not being hyperbolic. Listen to how he described it to the Detroit News. He said, quote, "I do drool when I think of the pace of change we could achieve under the new law. Power tastes great, more thrilling. I do drool." But the fact is that this guy used to feel throttled by the people who the people of Detroit elected to make decisions about schools in their city. Now, under the new law, whoever you elect locally, totally irrelevant. Before the new law went into effect, the school's emergency manager said he wanted to close Katherine Ferguson Academy. It was slated for closure last year as part of Detroit Public Schools emergency financial manager Robert Bob's plan to downsize the school system, but protests from students and community members kept it open. Manager wanted to shut down the city's special school for girls who were pregnant or who had kids, but protests, again, from students and community members kept it open. Now with expanded unilateral power, all teachers in the Detroit schools just got layoff notices from this person. And the girls at Katherine Ferguson Academy just found out that their school has been put on this list. Look, closures or charters with a big asterisk on it. The asterisk means, quote, proposals will be requested to operate these schools as charters. If an acceptable proposal is not submitted for a school, then it will be closed during the summer of 2011. What that means in simple terms is that Katherine Ferguson High School is on the block. The emergency overseer has made a unilateral decision about Katherine Ferguson Academy. If a private company will take over Katherine Ferguson Academy and keep it open, then maybe it can stay open in some form, whatever the company wants to do with it. If not, it's gone this summer. When he tried to do it before, the emergency manager tried to close down this before, it was local protests that stopped him. Now, with that one emergency overseer being given unlimited power to do what he wants, no matter what Detroit says, well, when the students got the news, they decided to protest. This video we showed a moment ago where these girls were talking about how much they love their school, how much they love Katherine Ferguson. You can see they're painting something there. What they're painting is protest signs. The video is from a sit-in at the school during spring break week last week. The girls got the news about what was going to happen to Katherine Ferguson Academy. They went to their school. They gathered inside. They made a collective decision to say, this is our place and we're staying. And then, of course, this is what happened next. City. The police turned on the sirens of their police cars to drown out the girls' voices while they were getting handcuffed and arrested for refusing to leave their schools. Their school. At least one teacher was arrested alongside them.
The attitude of the teachers was really plain. It was, we can find a job somewhere else, but these young women, they can't replace this school. If we don't stand and fight with them for their futures, then they don't stand a chance.
The news now from Michigan is not about whether Katherine Ferguson Academy stays open or it closes, or about what happens to Benton Harbor and the lakefront park there that we've been talking about and its privatization into a really, really expensive golf course. It's not even about whether there are political forces in America that want to drop the idea of public schooling, to turn schools into business opportunities instead, or to turn public parks into golf courses. Those political forces exist. They have existed for a long time. That is not new. What is new here is that this state has decided that local elections, locally elected officials, are a problem that has to be done away with. That democracy is in the way of fixing problems in the United States now, of making things more efficient, particularly in poor places. Not that democracy is the way we fix problems, but that democracy is the problem, and it therefore needs to be sidestepped for efficiency's sake, for our own good. The governor knows best. This week, a columnist with the Kalamazoo Gazette wrote a thoughtful and smart column that, frankly, was really critical of me, really critical of us for our coverage of the takeover of Benton Harbor. The columnist's name is Julie Mack, and she wrote in response to our coverage, quote, what's worse for Benton Harbor, a financial manager with dictatorial powers or an utterly dysfunctional city government? Dictator or dysfunction? Dictator or dysfunction? Only two options? Really? The point here, what makes Benton Harbor a national story and Katherine Ferguson Academy a national story, is that the whole idea of choice for them anymore is purely hypothetical. The state has chosen for them. And what they've got is, frankly, that aforementioned dictator. Their hope, their one hope, is that the dictator is benevolent. Is that how we think problems should get solved in America now? That is why Michigan is ground zero for American politics right now at Benton Harbor and at Katherine Ferguson. I'll be right back.